the days ahead. Yesterday, I was in my office preparing for a wedding that I conducted yesterday afternoon, and as I was in the office early, tears flooded down my cheeks as I concentrated what the enemy was just doing with some of the members of our flock's lives. It's in our toughest times that we're provided with the most teachable moments. Today, I want to take what could potentially be destructive and make it beneficial. The things that Satan uses for evil, God works for good. I don't know how Romans 8:28 comes to play, but I know it's in the book, and I know it's true. I've proven it over again. A week or two ago, I made the statement that Satan can get to one person, he can get to one family. If he can get to one family, he can get to one church. If he can get to one church, he can get to one city. If he can get to one city, he can get to one county. If he can get to one county, he can get to one state. If he can get to one state, he can get to one country. And if he can get to one country, he can get to one world. It starts with this one. It's my obligation as a watchman. And Samuel said to roll the pastor, number one, he said right off the bat, was what? A protector. I'm here as a watchman, I'm here as a protector. And I have to keep the enemy from dividing this congregation. I'm going to address some issues without going into great depth and detail. But I want you to hear my words. I want you to hear my heart. I want you to listen carefully to what I'm about to say. We have been inundated this week with comments and conversation that is causing concern for me. I want you to understand one thing right now. It is not our responsibility to determine guilt or innocence in the life of any individual. I'm going to say that again. It is not the responsibility of the church to determine innocence or guilt in any individual. It is our responsibility, however, to heal the hurting and restore the fallen. We are never to rejoice in someone else's pain. We are never to rejoice in someone else's pain if we think it's a victory. This last week, I think America was shocked in a positive way by a young man who responded to a woman police officer who had murdered his brother. Some of you saw that on the news, some of you saw it on the internet. But this young man, even to a guilty party, wrapped his arms around this woman and said, "I wish you no ill. I'm not here to see you hurt, I want you healed. And what you really need is a relationship with Jesus Christ." If the church could respond that way on an everyday basis, what a better place the church would be. They've often said, they've often declared, and I'm preaching something I've lived through. I have lived through this myself. I'm preaching from personal experience. They often said that the church is the only institution that shoots the wounded. God help us. God help us. God help us not to shoot our wounded, no matter who they are or what is going on. We're called to do repairs of the bricks and things. The man I'm hanging over here to my far left and your far right tells you that. We are called to do repairs of the bricks. Satan seeks to bring division, but God wants restoration. Today, listen to me. Understand the strength of my heart. I said Wednesday night, I feel like a father watching one of my children going through a painful process, and my heart breaks for all involved. Not one child or another child or this child or that child, because they're all our family. We don't know how this devastates your pastor. That I hurt when you hurt. That I feel what you feel. And if I could do anything at this moment in time, I would love to just wrap my arms around those who are hurting and just weep with them. You see, we need to embrace our brothers and sisters and not discard them or discredit them. Division is the one thing that causes love to hate. Proverbs 6:16-19 says, the Lord hates and God is love. But seven are abominations, they that sow discord among the brethren. And when you begin to have a party spirit, you begin to choose sides instead of loving all and ministering to each one. I want to tell you what you are doing is you're causing division. Five divisions, two divisions, and we are one body. Ephesians 4 is where I'm drawing my text that's all the introductory, laying the groundwork for where I'm headed. Verse 1 through 3 of Ephesians 4, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The greatest threat to the church does not come from the outside. You've heard me say this over and again. It comes from within. The Lone Ranger and Tonto were riding through a deep canyon when all of a sudden Indians appeared on both hills to their right and to their left. The Lone Ranger turned to Tonto and said, what are we going to do? Tonto said, what do you mean we, Ranger? How easy it is in difficult situations to discard people you love. How easy it is in difficult situations to throw away people who are hurting and broken because we feel they are flawed and fragmented and less than we are. But unity matters to God. Psalm 133. David said, behold, how good. Everybody say good. And how pleasant, say pleasant. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard of Aaron's beard, and it went down to the skirts of his garments, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. I will be very brief this morning in my comments. I'm not going to preach a long sermon, but I'm going to convey a vital truth. I'm going to give you three simple points to some unity this morning. Number one, let's talk about the value of unity. How many know that unity is costly? It'll cost you your pride. We need to know is unity is pleasant. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Verse 3 of Psalm 133 said, there the Lord commanded the blessing. You see how important unity is, the value of unity. Without unity, there's no blessing. It's in the place of unity that God brings the blessing of the Lord that makes rich and adds no sorrow. Because unity is pleasant. That word pleasant means delightful, sweet, or pleasing. Galatians 5 and verse 15. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed one of another. And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 24 and 25, for our public hearts have no need. But God has kept it or mixed or blended the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked. That there should be no schism, no tear, no rift, no break in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. It's a pleasant thing to dwell in unity. In Warrensburg, New York, where I graduated from high school when my father passed me, the Hudson River was flowing through that little community. It's in the Adirondacks, and there's a place just north of town, outside of town, a couple miles. It's a canoe access site where you can put your canoes and kayaks into the river. The Hudson River there is just beautiful. This is one of those serene places. You pull into the parking area, you park your car, and you're surrounded by the canopy of pine trees and pine needles cover the ground. A trail walks about a quarter of a mile back down through that canopy of pine needles, and the aroma of the pine is just awesome, and the beauty that surrounds it is incredible. And as you get to the end of the trail, there is the Hudson River with big rocks and rippling white caps, and it's just a beautiful picturesque place there on the Hudson River. This is up in the north before you get down to the south where the Hudson becomes very wide and deep. This is the pretty part where it's flowing through the rocks and the mountains. And how pleasant it is sometimes when I visit there, I will make a special trip just to go to the canoe access site because I can just sit down and take a deep breath and inhale the aroma of the pines and just see the beauty that God created. It's so pleasant. You just want to be there. You know, a pleasant place is a place that you want to be. People want to be where people get along. How many are looking forward to Thanksgiving and Christmas and family reunions? And how many are looking forward to it with a little bit of trepidation because you know when the family gets together, there will be some unrest? We don't like it when there's unrest in the family gathering. Amen? Nobody wants to go home and find brothers and sisters and parents bickering around the Thanksgiving table. You just as soon not go. It's a pleasant thing to be where brothers and sisters get along and love one another. It's not pleasant where they fight and compare and critique and tear each other apart. It's a pleasant place to not only is the place of unity a pleasant place, it's a precious place. He said it's like the dew or like the ointment, the precious ointment. How many know the word precious means desirable? It means valuable, extremely valuable. And I want you to know unity is extremely valuable to God. It's not only pleasant, it's precious. Romans 16:17 says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, mount them with strong conviction to the sense of counseling to the doctrine if you want to avoid them." God says, stay away from people who cause division. Because it matters to him about unity. Proverbs 6:16-19, "These 6 things that the Lord hates, these 7 are abominations unto him. A proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, and a heart that devises wicked imaginations. Feet that be swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among the brethren." God said, I do not like disunity. It's not precious to me. What's precious to me is when brethren dwell together in unity. I know, I understand this. Unity produces comfort. Because when you talk about the oil that flows on Aaron's head and on his beard, the oil is the type of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is the comforter. When you get in a place of unity, you get in a place where you're comforted, not crucified. It wasn't the crowd that was part of the church that crucified Christ. Not the church that really loved him. It was the people that despised him. We need to come to a place where we are comforted and not crucified. We don't need people pointing out their fingers at us because we're going through a hard time. We need somebody embracing us, holding out a hand, extending it, Amen. If we do that this morning, amen, we extend a hand. We aren't pointing any fingers. We are comforting those that mourn. The Bible tells us to do so. If you read about that precious ointment, the Bible says what it was composed of. First of all, the ingredients of that precious ointment were myrrh. Myrrh was a root that when it was crushed and beaten down, it produced a spice that was used to embalm the dead body. It stopped the stench and the smell of the decay of death. You see, unity flows out of brokenness. Unity flows out of being crushed. When you have been crushed, you understand what those who are being crushed are feeling and going through. You can empathize and you can sympathize a little better when you've been through it yourself. You see, if you have never been crushed, then unity really doesn't matter as much to you as it does if you've been crushed. Myrrh is a precious part of the ingredients to compose the ointment that is the unity that God speaks of. Second ingredient is cinnamon. It's that which is sweet to the taste, the sense of not being bitter. How many know that where there's disunity, there's bitterness? Because when you choose sides, the next thing you know is you get angry. And when you don't deal with anger, you become bitter. And you begin to point fingers and hatred begins to rise. And that's where it all begins. And if you don't nip it in the bud before it starts, let me tell you, the root of bitterness springs up real quick. Don't ever get a be against them attitude. We're in this thing together. Amen. I'll say it again. Don't ever get a be against them attitude. This is a we're in this together. We're to support one another, to heal one another, to mend one another, and to be a blessing to one another. We cannot allow bitterness to creep in. Unity does not allow bitterness to head out of any place in its vicinity. When it came to Mara, the water was too bitter to drink. Mara means bitter. We don't need bitterness here. We need cinnamon, something that's sweet, not bitter. Then the third item was sweet cane. That also speaks of being sweet to the taste, but not in the sense of not being bitter, but not being sour. How many know it speaks of joy? Greater unity is joy. Amen. Where people are getting along, there's a happy place. Amen. It's not a happy place where people aren't getting along. It's not a happy place. Hebrews 13:17. Obey them that have rule over you and submit yourselves to they that watch for your souls, as they that must give account that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that's what's profitable to you. I said on Wednesday night, if you really want to bless your pastor, then let him minister with joy. Amen. Don't argue, fight, and just get into a place of attitude. The fourth and final ingredient of this precious ointment is passion. That's a very wholesome ingredient, and it really speaks of holiness. You see, unity is a sign of true spirituality. True spirituality doesn't brag, I got all the answers, and I know what's going to happen here, and that's not true spirituality. It's not happening. True spirituality brings unity. It brings amending. Jennifer and I are here to bring unity to the body, not division. Our heart is to love you all the same. We don't have favorites, and I'll tell you that right here from my heart. Somebody said, well, you have favorites. No, I don't have favorites. I love you all the same. I may spend time with one more than another because we have common interests or we have common ministry, but that doesn't mean my love is any different. I will be there for you when you need me as much as anybody else. I'll be there for. I don't have a favorite, and I want you to know that Jennifer and I have remained neutral. We love you all. This is Pastor Appreciation Month, and we are appreciative of you. Not only are we going to talk about the value of unity, let's talk about the voice of unity. 1 Corinthians 1:10. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing, and let there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and the same judgment. That means we all have to have the same opinion. No, my father said if we all had the same opinion, one of us would be necessary. We all come from different vantage points. We have different genders, we have different upbringings, we have different experiences. We all have different inputs that cause us to see things differently. If every one of us were to stand across the front of this church and pick out one item we see, we'd probably all see something different from the person next to us. We all have different opinions, keep it to yourself. Well, Pastor, if we all have different opinions, how can we all speak the same thing? Because we have one Lord, one Spirit, we have one Word. Amen? And let me tell you, we all may have opinions, but God's Word comes from your opinion. And you need to speak what God says, not what you say, not what I say, not what other people say. You need to be talking what God says. And if we all come back to what God has said and start speaking what God has spoken, then we're speaking the same thing. Last week today, this week, I'm trying to get the name back to you somehow. Proverbs 18 and verse 6. A fool's lips are only the protection of his mouth, calleth for strokes. His mouth never gives it attention. A fool, I didn't call it that. Like Mr. King, Amos 3:3, how could you walk together except to be a dream? You don't come together, you fall apart. If this body doesn't stay together, it will fall apart. Satan has brought the vision already, you don't need to have time to have the vision into the Bible. They were in the wilderness. They were all happy to get out. They were all shouting praises and leading them when they crossed the Red Sea. They were all singing, shouting, dancing, biking, and all that stuff until they got to their mark. And they all started to pray. Then there was a change of opinion. Listen, Mr. Moses, you brought us out here to kill us. We left us alone, we'd rather die in Egypt and be out here and all of a sudden the Romans started. And if you read Numbers, it says that that Roman had its origin in the Hebrew Jerusalem, it's the mixed multitude, those that went through the sea. I want to tell you, all Roman has its origin in the Hebrew Jerusalem. We need to speak the same things. 12 spies were sent out to check out the promised land. 10 of them said, well, 12 of them said the same thing. They said it's a land that flows with milk and honey, and the trust of the grapes is so big that it takes 2 men to carry them. All 12 said the same thing, but then 10 of them said, we got something else that we don't agree with you to see us now. And that's the fact that the giants in the land that we can't possess them. They didn't speak the gospel, but the gospel they could possess them. Caleb and Joshua said, we're well able to possess them. But the 10 said, we're going to be divided, we're going to cause discord in the camp. We're going to cause people not to go forward when God told us to go forward. So we're not going to speak what God speaks, we're going to speak what we speak. A lot of us see certain things. And maybe what you see is right, I'm not saying it's wrong. It may be right, it may be wrong, but let God sort it out. And in the meantime, do what God says. Speak the same thing that there is no division in the body. I have an obligation to protect this flock from being scattered. And that's what I will do. I will be the pastor God called me to be. And if you don't want me as a pastor, vote me out. Somebody shouting, they own me. I'm just telling you the truth. But as long as I stand here, I will not run when the wolf comes. I I will love you through it all. I will love you through it all. I will love you through it all. I will not throw you away. But let me tell you, I look at myself and I know I need grace every day. I'll give grace because I need grace. But that doesn't mean that I will not address issues that must be addressed. We can't have this side, that side, the other side. We're all on God's side. The Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul said, you're carnal, you're not spiritual, you're carnal. Because one said, I'm choosing Paul's side. Well, I'm choosing Apollos. I'm of Cephas. I've got my side all picked off. He said, you're carnal. Not one of those guys died for you. You need to be on the Lord's side. When you start choosing sides, you're not spiritual, you're carnal. You need to be on God's side, and God's side is to bring healing to the hurting and restoration to the fallen. The power of Babel, this is the voice of victory. God came down at the Tower of Babel when they said, we're going to build a tower to reach the heavens. And they begin to build. And you know what God did? He came down and he confused them. He brought different languages in to confuse them because he said, nothing shall be withheld from them because they're all speaking the same thing. There's power and victory when we all speak the same thing. And what we need to be speaking is what God has already spoken. Because God has the final say. Amen? God has the final say. In situations that I deal with, I pray, God, shall not the judge of all the earth do right, and I put my faith in you to bring a right result, and in the meantime, I am going to trust God and speak his word. Not only is the value in unity, not only do we need the same voice for unity, but victory in unity. Judges chapter 20, verse 11, for all the men of Israel were gathered against the city, lived together as one man. If you want victory, you've got to be unified. One nation, and a little one country that cities that were born. And I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under the God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. You know what the problem was? America's falling apart because we've become divided. A house or a nation or a city divided cannot stand. We're still one nation. But we're still one body, we're still one church, and we cannot let divisions come in. And the divisions come in because various opinions that do not speak what God has spoken. And what will happen to any church or anybody who is a Christian if they allow division to come in? You will soon fall apart. Acts chapter 2, 1 through 4. Whether they are Pentecost or fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. They were in what? One accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. There appeared unto them golden tongues like as a fire, and it fell upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. The Holy Ghost was poured out in a place of unity. Getting along. Speaking the same thing. Amen. One accord. Israel was in the battle. Moses stood on the mountain. As long as Moses raised his hands, Israel was winning the fight. But when his arms got weary and tired and he began to let them droop to dry, Israel began to move. So there were two men in Israel that came along. One's name was Aaron and the other's name was Hur. And he said, you can't do it alone. dwelling with women. And they held up the hands of Moses and Israel won the battle because there was unity in the body. If there's going to be victory in Central Assembly, there must be unity in the body. It cannot be division. Gideon gets your army together, and I use Gideon a lot, but Gideon applies to a lot of things. Gideon gets your army together. I want you to defeat the Midianites. You know, 135,000 Midianite soldiers to come against Israel, and so Gideon gathered his army of 32,000. God said to Gideon, "Go have too many men. Tell those who are afraid to go home." Gideon said, "I only have 32,000, we have 135,000. God said, "Yeah, and we're going to save my own men and save them, they will take the trouble. Tell those who are afraid to go home." God is not sharing glory with another. God doesn't care if you want to take the credit and don't bother coming. If he's not going to give you the glory, I get the praise and he gets the glory. 22,000 left, he's left with 10,000. God says to give you, go down to the brook and give them a test. Those that bend over and laugh like a dog, send them home. And those that cup it in their hand and drink with a cup in their hand, you keep them. Only 300 kept it in their hand, and 9,700 left it like a dog to be sent home, and now he has 300. Why did God tell Gideon to send those that left it like a dog home? Because they were only satisfied themselves drinking their own water, but those that kept it could be alert to watch out for their brothers and sisters to the fight. They could be alert to take care of one another. And God wanted people that cared about others more than themselves in the battle, in honor for caring one another. We know the story. They were stripped out with 300 men, then God took the weapons away. Then God said, "I want you to go on three mountains, this mountain, that mountain, and this mountain, and here's the Midianites down in the valley between them. I don't want you to have any weapons, but I want you to have a lamp, a pitcher, and a trumpet. And when I give you the word Gideon, I want you to break your pitcher and let your light shine. And when you break your pitcher, I want 299 others to break their pitchers and let their light shine. When I tell you Gideon, I want you to blow your trumpet. When you blow your trumpet, I want 299 other men to blow their trumpet." Gideon thought, "Great. You want us to shine our light so they see where we're at and sound the alarm to tell them we're here. We don't have any way to defend ourselves, and you're setting us up for a slaughter." God said, "Just do it my way. Speak what I say, not what you say." So Gideon got his three armies together, 100 men on that hill, 100 men on that hill, and 100 men on that hill. Last thing he knew, his friends and numbers, and God said, "I want you to take three armies to run them, because some of those things surround you. When you go, when you break your pitcher, I want 299 men to break your pitcher. When you blow your trumpet, I want 299 men to blow your trumpet." What would have happened if Gideon blew his trumpet? Some guy in the Nightingale blew his trumpet, another guy over here blew his trumpet, then one guy up here blew his trumpet. What would have happened? When they had victory. You see, what happened is when 300 men all blew their trumpet at the same time, you maybe heard that. They thought that they were outnumbered. They thought there were hundreds of thousands. They drew down in the valley, and the sound of the trumpets was amplified down in the valley. It was wraparound stereo. They didn't know how many trumpets were there, but it sounded more than 300. It sounded like 300,000. And when they came out of the tent and looked up, they didn't see one little candle over on this hill and one candle on that hill. They saw lights on that hill, lights on that hill, and lights on that hill, and they were surrounded, and by the sound of the noise of the trumpet, they thought it was a great multitude, and they panicked and killed each other. What would have happened if they all did their own thing one at a time instead of doing it all together at the same time? See, there's victory in unity. There's value in unity. It's pleasant. People want to come where the church gets along. Nobody's coming in where there's fighting and everybody posts on Facebook every opinion under the sun. Trash that stuff. Let's post the positive. Let's post what Christ would have us post. The praise for broken lives. We're here to lift up those that are struggling and hurting, not to point fingers, but extend hands and throw embraces around us. We love you. We may not see eye to eye, but I'll tell you one thing. We suck. Oh, I've said it before. I've said it a few times already this week. I've been at the top, and I'm not impressed by that position. I like the view from the cross. We all need to get a view from Calvary. Start loving the way Jesus loved us. I'm so glad he didn't sit on the cross picking up the pot saying what a filthy wretch he is, because I'm the filthiest. Let me tell you, it was your sin and my sin that no one did that trick for those who copied thinking you all that and a whole box of something.
Morning, Pastor.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.